Marlon Baker. Death by chocolate. What you will see is nothing but your imagination. What you will hear is the shocking truth about my life. Death by chocolate is no normal short movie. Death by chocolate is something special. A temptation you can taste best when just closing your eyes and listen to the story. Justin Beaty, that's me, has to tell you. So make sure to make yourself comfortable, relax and close your eyes as soon as you have clicked the play button. Enjoy that amazing short story, based on real events. Justin Beaty was an ordinary boy who attended an ordinary school and more likely an average performance. He had the same common hobbies and interests, like his classmates, and yet this boy was exceptional. Justin weighed in not a lot for his 12 years. He took just 35¾ pounds on the scale, and basically his weeks were the same as of any other child. Except Sundays, they have never been ordinary to him, until now. But until that moment, nor should a lot of unusual things happen. A series of mysterious events, if you will, the unstoppable took their course, and want to be told here. Justin Beaty lived in a very ordinary town, in an unremarkable street, so that one could believe that this place could be found anywhere in the world, and that his life basically was not much interesting to write a story about. In his home, he felt well. Here he lacked nothing. In any event, from Monday to Saturday, his world seemed to run in an orderly fashion, but for the Sundays in Justin's life, they had been quite extraordinary all the time. While his classmates were able to recover from the school days of the week and usually were sleeping until afternoon, Justin Beaty had a very early start getting out of bed, and that bugged him very much. It bugged him so much that he began to hate Sundays. But why he began to hate Sundays, you'll ask yourself surely. Was it perhaps the fact that he became a minister and at the urging of his parents, because his parents understood so exceptionally well with the pastor? And because they did so well with the pastor, they thought this would open the door to heaven when they eventually blessed the temporal. But that was not really the reason why Justin Beaty began to hate Sundays, and we must consider the daily routine of the boy to actually understand what was so wrong with the Sundays for him. What did Justin Beaty so unusual on Sundays, that he liked them all wiped out from the calendar? Between the first mass on a Sunday morning at the point of 8 o'clock, and the second mass, the midday mass at 12 o'clock, there were exactly 4 long hours. A precious time, like it seemed. Even Justin would have stayed much longer in his bed as all the other boys, or spend the time with the most ordinary things in life. But as I said, Sundays were no ordinary days for Justin. They were so unusual, as this young fellow was himself. And that was something the boy hated most. Whenever the morning mass was over, he had to hurry to get home in time, because there was already waiting the next time-consuming task for him. Justin's father had no extraordinary job, nothing special that would stand out here, with the result that his father brought only an average wage home, which was so tight that Justin did not even receive any kind of pocket money, but remarkably little, namely nothing. That was mainly the reason why the boy used the time between the two mass on Sundays to earn his own money, even if he hated the work like the plague. And even more than the job he was doing in church. Whenever he came home from the morning mass, an unusually large pile of newspapers was waiting for him, that he had to distribute to more or less ordinary or average people. Justin Beaty could not dawdle on the way, even though there were many temptations on his path through the streets. He was quite glad to have a bike available for the hard work that he had bought from his own hard-earned money. Well, it was more a wage, instead of pocket money. Every Sunday morning Justin was responsible for nothing less than well over 100 people were sitting at their kitchens, satisfied to read in the newspaper what happened in their usual city during the week. His tour took him through the same old roads, and to the same ordinary houses and people, and he had never received an unusually large tip, although he tried his very best to get it right to every individual. And many readers of this newspaper believed that Justin Beaty was able to be in two places at the same time, so that each one in his newspaper lying on the table in time for breakfast, something like 9 o'clock. Usually, the boy justified himself with the same sentence, "I am not that extraordinary, as you might think of me. I am not aware that I could be in two places at the same time, so I apologize to you. I'm just an ordinary boy who has never produced something extraordinary." But for Justin Beaty it was the same week after week, month after month and year after year, and the whole mess had started when he asked his father, who was indeed paid only ordinary, for a new bike for Christmas, and the only answer he returned was,
"I cannot afford such an extraordinary request on my modest salary. Since you already have a job yourself, you have to earn the money for a new bicycle yourself. There are many extraordinary things that even such an ordinary boy like you can do to make money."
And that was the birth of the idea. Justin could be able to do two jobs on Sundays. Two time-consuming activities on Sunday mornings, where boys usually were still asleep and dreaming, at best of a new bike, and although the activity of being a ministrant was not even worth a cent, only for funerals or weddings he received a small tip, his father always told him that God in heaven would ensure that he meets his righteous wage when the time came for him to enter the heaven's portal. And God's reward for his loyal devotion was something so extraordinary for such a precious ordinary boy, as he was. "But why need to be rewarded when I am dead?" Justin asked himself, but he had no choice. But until then, Justin Beaty was also not unusual. It all started much later on. In order to waste no time, he counted the newspapers, put them in a burlap bag, which he strapped himself in spite of the weight over his shoulders and was like every Sunday morning on his way. Now, Justin Beaty was anything but a boy, who was exceptionally strong, and so he took a little longer for this activity as usually conducted, as it would have made another boy his age, perhaps, and that was not the only thing for which Justin took longer than anyone else. Often he was the one who had a disadvantage, whenever there was to see something extraordinary. While the others already had been there, he was still on the road and kicking like crazy in the pedals of the old bicycle without gears. But for such his money was not enough, so he had to settle for an average bike, so pure that it had nothing extraordinary. Not even a porter or a street light, although it was mandatory. But that was not so much his problem. Whenever he delivered the newspapers or standing near the pastor and hopeful begged for divine assistance, ordinary boys still slept and did not see how much he struggled with the newspapers or the exceptionally steep streets, which he always saved for the end of his tour. Usually he has never been spoken much to a customer, when he threw the paper in a high arc to the front doors, unless he aimed inaccurate, and the paper ended up in a rhododendron bush or in the rain barrel. Their shouting was great. On a special day it happened that he should be addressed, but that day was still far off. First he had to ride home after his tour, wash his hands thoroughly, because the printer's ink stained his hands all black on Sunday mornings, until he rushed to the church, pulled over the garment and stood very close to the pastor again. Then, when all activities were done, he hurried back home, dined with his parents for lunch and then spent the rest of the day like any other ordinary child of his age. During the week, between the Sundays, he lined up like any other child in the queue to wait for the bus, presented his monthly pass and ran with the same complacency toward the classroom, like all the other boys, too. Here he was surprised by nothing. Each school day was so extraordinarily ordinary, that he often lost in daydreams in which he was an exceptional boy, some kind of a hero, if you like to hear that. His teachers hated it at all when he was daydreaming. And Justin Beaty also liked his teachers not very much, very particularly his gym teacher, and Justin probably hated sports more than anything else in his life. There was nothing to be hated more for Justin, than having to spend 2 hours in sports class, although he failed miserably the most ordinary exercises. He could not even pull himself up on a rope, or jump over a wood block. He therefore attempted to give his best. But it never seemed enough for his teachers or the other boys in class. His classmates laughed at him, usually when he was hanging like a wet bag on the rope or when he bounced against the wood block with full force, rather than just jump over it like the others, and that hurt him often so much, that he thought more often about how he could pay back to the others. Whenever it was possible, he avoided to become the laughingstock of his mean classmates. They had not the same problem as him. The others were far too common, as they might have a problem like Justin had. But he knew that revenge was a mortal sin, and forging for revenge would already make him a sinner. The pastor always claimed that revenge was even an extraordinary mortal sin.
It's your free ticket to a guaranteed right to purgatory, directly to hell with all the other ordinary sinners.
That was not very funny for Justin at all, because he didn't want to be a sinner, and he didn't want to meet the guys who came directly out from hell. It was enough already for him to know evil people who did him wrong often, or sinned with him. And of those, there were quite a lot. He was often the underdog, who pocketed the blows usually, if not more. But after a normal week in August, the exceptional day that Justin Beaty's life will change dramatically finally came. And for how long he had longed for such a change. It was once a hated Sunday morning when the boy had to get up earlier than everyone else, because his alarm clock did not pity him, and tore him from the sweetest dreams. Like on every other Sunday morning of the last 2 years, he dressed himself fine for the morning mass and then ran to the church, but unlike the usual hypocrites of the city. Finally, he was a ministrant and was allowed to stand very close to the pastor. This made him extraordinary, and this day should be more unusual than any day before in his young life. After the morning mass, the boy ran as fast as he could at home to count the newspapers, grabbed them in his bag, and slung in spite of the weight over his shoulders and made his way to deliver the papers on time. It was an ordinary trip, up to the moment when Justin discovered a door that stood invitingly open, although it should be closed normally at this early hour. He laid down his bike in the heavy bag and ran towards the open door, which seemed to magically attract him, somehow. That was very unusual, because he usually did not make any longer stops on his tour. The time scale for the tour was already much too short. But Justin cared little at that moment, which was very unusual, because Justin Beaty was usually a very dependable boy. What was the magic of this old house, so that it sucked Justin into the spell? He did not know. So far he had never noticed this house especially, and no person lived in that house who subscribed the newspaper. He did not even know exactly who lived in the dilapidated house, which looked from the outside in such a way as no one entered it for a very long time. But Justin wanted to be certain. He wanted to know who lived in this house, and who lured him there, with sweet promises.
"Come in, my boy. It is just the right time that we introduce another,"
a voice whispered. Justin was scared. Should he really enter the house, from which it was said that there lived a real witch, who was mighty of spellcasting? But these were just tales, or not? And the people of this city told that to each other only, because they did not really know who lived here. And witches? I am 12 and not 8. His belief in such beings and creatures had been exhausted at the age of 9, when he had been stripped of the illusion that there were creatures that lived beyond their world. And as soon as he had found the Santa Claus costume in the bottom drawer on his father's dresser, his childhood imagination was gone forever. But that's a story that wants to be told another time. Let us concentrate rather on that magical moment, when Justin made his first footstep over the threshold of this old house. That was such an extraordinary moment for Justin, that the spittle got stuck in his throat, and he hardly produced any word as he faced the occupant of this house in person. Malice, this is how the old woman was called by most of the people behind closed doors only, and in the same breath often fell, that she was able to fulfill you every wish. Even Justin had already heard of her dark gift, but had always kept away from her home, because the priest constantly threatened him with sanctions, the fires of hell, even if he relies on the magical arts of this ancient Wicca, and no less than her soul would be placed in danger. But now there was no way back anyway. Justin had already exceeded more than the threshold of the house. He was suddenly right in the middle of their witch's kitchen, where there was to admire so many extraordinary things. Jars in all imaginable yellows, oranges and reds, and probably only Malice knew what was inserted in these jars. Spices. And their heavy scents drifting through the kitchen, and it smelled wonderful, like Christmas. Anyway. Cinnamon, nutmeg, cloves, cardamom. A gingerbread house would smell probably like that, Justin thought and stretched out his dirty right hand to the woman not to be held rude. Finally, he had entered her house, and it was proper to introduce each other. My name is Justin. Justin Beaty. I deliver the newspapers on Sunday mornings. Do you want to buy a newspaper? Justin looked at the kitchen table. The old woman was into a rather unusual hobby. She cuts out articles from the newspapers to archive them. That's a hobby in the city, Justin recalled. Not many ordinary people are into. But Malice was anything but an ordinary woman. When Justin pushed aside his first fear, Malice offered him fresh baked ginger biscuits.
You are quite skinny for your age, just skin and bones. It's a miracle that you're still strong enough to deliver all those newspapers,
Malice said, as she put a saucer on the table, on which there were 5 biscuits for Justin. Without asking the boy, she put a glass of fresh milk on the table, until she sat down on a chair and said,
sugar, cream, cocoa and milk, all common ingredients, at first glance, right? But did you know that chocolate can kill you?
Justin continued that it might be better for him to put the half-eaten cookie back to the little plate, but he did not want to appear rude, biting instead one more time in the cookie. But he didn't know how to answer Malice's question, and so he lifted his shoulders only.
In a month, there will be a cake bazaar hosted by the church. I want to bake the sweetest cake ever,
Malice said, and Justin thought she wanted to participate for the first prize to be won. But he was wrong.
This sweet temptation will kill them all, one by one. They will not be able to resist this cake. They will eat it, even though they know each piece of it will kill them.
Justin knew cakes that had the death on their behalf. Death by Chocolate was such a cake, and it was also their favorite cake of his parents and of the pastor, and it was probably as good as the favorite cake of all who lived here in this ordinary city. But why Malice told him about her plan to compete on the cakes competition? Wouldn't she risk that her diabolical plan would be discovered to poison all people with an overdose of chocolate? The longer Justin was in this house, the more and more extraordinary things he discovered. He saw cooking utensils, which were not found in the average home, and there were ingredients that would most probably reject, until he picked up a shelf and his eyes starts glowing, when he saw the numerous empty jars standing there, and he wondered what made these jars so special, that Malice seemed to collect them. It was no longer a secret to the old witch, that Justin stared to the jars on the shelf for a long time, and so she initiated him into another secret.
These are wish jars, you know. Precious artifacts from long forgotten times.
Justin's attention was there. Yes, that was really something he would now most necessary to be able to. Simply wish something that came true. But should he throw out his heart to that old woman that there was something in his life that he could not stand any longer? One day he would collapse under that burden, that he knew very well. But whether he could trust this person, he could not say. Malice was mysteriously. Hardly anyone really knew much about her. Everyone knew only that she lived in the Mystery Lane at number 13. But to suggest that a disaster would come over you when staying longer in that house, or you no longer would be even alive when leaving it, were nothing but old wives' tales that are told in the city to the children to keep them away from the temptation. A wish could be fulfilled here, just after a single blink. Wish jars, Justin replied after careful consideration, if he should respond. What are they good for?
They can fulfill you every wish. But everyone gets only 3 wishes. This is how it works. Do you have a wish you want fulfilled?
Well, who in this miserable city does not have that need? Justin thought, but did not want to say right away that his most urgent request was outside on the lawn, for how wonderful it would be to have a new bike, with all the extras a boy is dreaming of? Just like that. I wish something I desire most and it just fulfill, just in skepticism prevailed. But when it is that easy, why not everyone simply wishes what they wanted most?
Just like that.
Malice said, and suggested that Justin would pick one of wish jars off the shelf. Justin wrestled. In the shelf, good 2 dozen of glasses were waiting to fulfill the boy's most desired dream come true, sorry, wish jars. And one was more beautiful than the other. They looked like candy glasses from an old mom and pop store. Glasses that Justin associated with his early childhood, as he had run in a kiosk every Sunday after church to spend the 50 cents for candy, instead of throwing them in the collection, as he's been entrusted to him by his mother. Finally, he was told to replenish his account for the end of his life, not to stand as loser in front of Heaven's gate, and he should really do something for his soul, because his mother had noticed even that the priest keeping an eye on the boys, Justin stretched. Ironically, the most inconspicuous of all wish jars had been focused by him, on top of the shelf. It was dustier than the others. It was not so nice shining as the others, and yet it was exactly right. Justin had found the desired jar, like it would be made just for him like it seemed. He carefully placed it on the kitchen table. Malice laughed. Then she said,
"You've made an excellent choice. This jar fulfills you every wish within a few moments."
Malice got up from the chair and went to the kitchen windows. She pulled down a window shade that darkened the room. Only a single candle on the table gave some light so as not to totally sit in darkness. Justin eagerly waited for the instructions, the spell he would recite. That is how it was told to work out, isn't it? Malice rummaged in a drawer in the kitchen buffets for paper and pen. Then she sat down with Justin at the table and spoke in a low voice.
"On this paper you have to write your request. Fold it twice lengthwise and then we'll see."
Justin wondered what his greatest wish was, because he believed the opportunity would come no second time, that he could make a wish. He wanted to start the spring, when he noticed that it was dry and Malice doesn't bring a keg of ink to the table. He looked quizzically at Malice. Without wasting a word, she hinted that Justin had to bite the pen tip in his fingertip to write this spring.
"With your blood, you will seal your desire."
As Justin had scheduled the spring, but still hesitated. Justin then stabbed with the pen tip in his left index finger. The spring immediately drawn to any blood that was swollen from the small wound. It did not hurt once. It tickled a lot more than it would someone gently stroking the finger. The pen slid across the paper, without Justin had to lead it. Rather, it seemed that the spring led him. The blood was good enough to write down a single word. Bike. More letters couldn't be written with the blood drops, he was willing to sacrifice. Justin then folded the paper twice the length and wondered why he should now put the paper on fire, because Malice set the candle next to him and said,
"Now you send off your request. Once the fire is extinguished, your wish will be fulfilled."
Malice opened the wish jar. Justin held the paper over the candle flame. Then it was suddenly dark. Even the candle went out on the table. Justin had the burning desire of paper fall into the jar, and was hoping, wishing, trusting. When he opened his eyes again, he stood outside the front door, and at first he seemed to experience a deja vu. Did he not go into this house for his last newspaper to sell? Justin wondered. Something extraordinary had happened to him, but he did not know what. He picked up his bag and the old bike, which he had deposited on the lawn. Then he drove off, and as he stepped into the pedals, he noticed that something was going on under his butt. The saddle was suddenly softer, and the link was no longer so cold, and he drove uphill now faster than ever before. Literally under his butt the old, rusty thing had transformed to a beautiful bike. A red bicycle which glittered. It was one kind of its own. It had a nice sounding bell, which he immediately expressed several times in a row. It had a 21-speed gear shift, and was exactly as he had imagined in his wildest dreams ever. Perfect. Back home, he brought the bike in the basement, because on the road he did not want it to be seen. In addition, He would certainly have to explain from where he got this bike. Justin could not tell his parents that the pastor had bought him a new bicycle. Also, he could not talk about what had really happened in the Misty Real Lane. If he would betray this spell, it would immediately dissolve into nothing but a dream. Yes, something like that had given him this old watch along the way. No one should know that he was getting a new bike through dark magic powers. And the days passed in which they all marveled at his unusual bike. Some of his classmates thought it could be a foreign model or even a custom made, what made it also an object of desire. Justin always had to be aware that he well chained it if he was not even close to it to admire himself on guard. After all, he was still stunned at how easy it was for anyone interested, who wanted malice, to fulfill something. And he wondered why not more people wanted her to have to fulfill a request. Was it perhaps that a certain reputation preceded old Malice, and that she was either ridiculed or favored to send her to hell? Justin visited Malice more frequently after that particular Sunday. Whenever he was near her house, he attended to help her in the garden. And he often made a detour, just to be able to be with Malice. He felt very comfortable with her, safe and secure. Home was no longer that way. His parents argued for days over the most trivial things. He often stood as a target in between, as his father often complained to his mother about what she had given birth to. A good for nothing. A failure. Words Justin wanted to wipe out of his memory, because they were offensive, and nearly felt the same, like his parents would kill him with a long sharp knife, each day a little more. Gradually it went up to the exceptional day of which was already mentioned at the beginning of this story. For the day when Justin wanted his new bike was nothing compared to the day that was to come closer every single second. Malice had tried all 7 recipes for a chocolate cake in recent days. But she could not decide what recipe she should be preferred. And Justin was always allowed to try until he became quite sick from too much sugar, the cream, cocoa, milk. But other very extraordinary things in his life struck him occasionally on the stomach. And he did not know where to start, as he told Malice. Not all adults are good to me. Some surely would want to kill me, because I know things about them that may never come out of the closet. Malice listened to the boy intently. Occasionally, she was so shocked by what the boy told her, that she couldn't eat one more bite of her cake. Justin's life seemed to fall apart at the seams. Many had done him great suffering. But the boy just did not know how to defend himself, or how to stop people from sinning against him. He was not some kind of candy others should lick their finger for. Malice keyword. She stood up again and took paper and spring from the drawer. Justin did not hesitate to get the wish jar from the shelf again. Finally, there were 3 wishes he could be fulfilled. He had already used 1 for the bike. Only 2 were left, he wanted to use to stop his opponents.
In a week we'll have a full moon,
Malice said, before she gave Justin pen and paper.
An extraordinary planetary alignment is coming up. In 7 days, almost everything will be possible, what you can possibly imagine.
Really everything?
Really everything.
Justin stabbed with the spring tip into the tip of his left thumb, hoping to squeeze out more blood of him than from his thin fingers. And the blood flowed in streams, as he held the spring in the blood drops. The spring became saturated. It felt as if the spring would not stop to drink his sweet sap. With this amount of blood ink, he could certainly write a whole letter. But it was only a single wish. A very unusual request for a young boy, which he now sent on the way, where he knew that the wish would actually come true and there would be no going back. But Justin wanted that desire to be fulfilled, even more than he desired a new bicycle. And if this request would bring no change in his life at all, he still had left the very last wish he would think twice of how to use it. Finally, he would have no chance to earn another 3 wishes. He put everything on one card. Or, as in his case, on the piece of paper that he folded twice lengthwise. Malice handed him the candle. Justin lit the paper. A magical moment ensued, in which everything blurred around him and looked out of focus. Malice laughed. Justin opened his eyes again, and again found himself in front of closed door. As he already wanted to run his bike, he noticed that the door opened behind him. He returns again and asks Malice, "Can you fulfill me my last wish in 7 days?
Maybe it's not necessary that you need it. Instead, I give you some of Herman."
Herman, Justin thought of nearly everything, a dog, a fat cat, a turtle. Malice wanted to give him foster care, but a cake mix?
"Today you get your Herman. He feels comfortable in a high, with a cloth-covered container in the refrigerator. On day one Herman is very hungry. Feed him with a cup of flour, 1 cup milk and 1/2 cup sugar and stir well to him. On day 2 to 4 he will be stirred daily. On day 5 it's feeding time again. On day 6 to 9 he would be stirred vigorously again. The 10th day will be then Herman's baking day. Grab a cup for the new Herman approach. For baking, you take the rest of Herman. You should not be eager, which is unfortunately most certainly be the case, because of what is left over, you have to pass some of those to whom is your greatest wish."
"But I have not yet committed my greatest wish to paper or to the wish jar."
"Isn't it obvious what you wish for deep down in your heart?"
Malice tapped her bony index finger to Justin's chest.
"Wishes should not to be spoken aloud as to fulfill itself."
"Okay." Justin grabbed the cup with the inconspicuous dough and put it in his pocket. The dough did not give the impression that it was something special.
"For many people Herman is not only a very special dough, but almost a family member. Herman cake sits at, or more on their, table every Sunday. Ancient families fed and lovingly stirred the dough, and turned it from generation to generation. You will probably do the same with yours."
Justin wondered at that very moment, how old this lump of dough was, and through how many hands he was already gone.
"Herman is simply a universal genius. It's good for delicious cake you can bake with it, but also super light Herman bread."
Justin wanted to give it a try. It surely was worth the time feeding this magic cake, and it seemed easy to follow the simple rules for breeding Herman. Still to this day, Justin fed his Herman with a cup of flour, 1 cup of milk and 1/2 cup of sugar, and stirred it well. And he should have known that a cake of Malice Witch's house was not just a regular cake, but something very special. Just magical. And a spell would grow in the coming days. On day 2 to 4 he stirred Herman once for a day. On day 5 was feeding time again. On day 6 to 9 he stirred Herman vigorously. Then there came the 10th day. Herman's baking day. Justin reminded himself that he should not bake all the dough into one cake, so he took a cup for the new Herman offspring. Malice words sounded in his ears.
"Because of what is left over of the dough, you need to pass on to those, which your greatest wish."
And Justin really wanted to pass on a dozen offspring, because the last few days were very exciting for him, while he took care of his Herman. And terrible things did happen around him. On the first day his parents had a violent quarrel. And since that time there was bad atmosphere at home. On the 5th day his new bicycle had been stolen, and although he knew in which garage it was now, neither his father nor the priest took any advantage of this information to get it back from the thief. A tearful night followed the day, and a few tears fell upon Herman, as Justin fed him. On the 7th day, a mob of classmates chased him on the whole way home, because he suddenly became so strange, so extraordinary. He wanted to tell anyone where he went in the afternoons, where he sat most of the time at Malice's kitchen table and unload a heavy burden from his shoulders. Malice listened attentively. She was sure that she had placed the boy the right tool in hand to put an end to that.
"Better an end with terror, than terror without end,"
she had told Justin all the time, when he quarreled if he would do the right thing. But there was also a day Justin was happy about, and that was the 10th day after he had taken home Herman. The dough was now a dozen times larger than the piece that he had received. Herman was wonderful risen and would certainly give a light and airy cake. Although Justin had been watching his mother rarely when she pushed a cake in the oven, he did not want help from her. After Mass, He had hardly time to look at the cake bazaar, because he still had to deliver the newspapers, but he left a little gift for the priest back in the sacristy. And without a bicycle his tour would take hours. He quickly ran home. Just as he walked in the door, he noticed two things. The whole house was enriched from a wonderfully sweet fragrance. Simply everywhere was the smell of the cake he had baked. And to his great surprise, his parents whispered sweet nothings as they were newly in love. So far, so good. His wish seemed to gradually dissolve in pleasure. If only these evil people would not wait on him, who all wanted to have the newspaper at the same time. Almost impossible. Justin gave his best. He ran from house to house, without a long stop at any door. Finally, he came at the end of his long tour passing Malice House. Actually, he wanted to sit in her kitchen and listen to her stories and wisdom, but at the front door was a note.
I am at the cake bazaar. Do not wait for me.
Justin was happy and sad at the same time. How gladly would he have been telling her about that his parents were no longer at loggerheads, and spoke and cuddled to each other again. He wanted to mingle with the people, just to see how his fortune cake was admired by the visitors of the cake bazaar. When finally came home, he found out that his mother had served unceremoniously on his cake, and he was beside himself with anger.
I'm not able to resist him. He smelled so delicious and tempting,
she said in her defense. Justin took the cake to the cake bazaar nevertheless. There, no one would notice that already a big piece was missing. Outside the church, the hell was going on. Half the city seemed to be on their feet. Everyone laughed and whispered, exchanged supposed secret recipes, how to bake a cake especially light, or they had their mouths so full that it was pretty disgusting to come closer to them, as crumbs flew directly to your face. Justin put his cake to all the others. At first he thought that he would not be considered further, as it seemed to be just a regular cake that an ordinary boy had baked. But over time the news spread like wildfire that you absolutely must try this cake. Justin sat on the curb a little offside and watched the hustle and bustle from a distance. Often, his eyes wandered over to the church square, but no trace of Malice. But he had already seen her cake. It stood in a prominent position and would probably make the race for the best cake of the day. The people seemed torn. What cake should now cast their votes? Justin did not expect to get any prize. And yet he was richly rewarded. After the while a play occurred beyond compare, and paid off for the long wait at the curb. At first it was only the finer ladies who suddenly vomited. They are downright puked their souls from their bodies. Justin smirked. That was exactly what he wanted to achieve. Those ladies who gave him hardly a smile when he brought the newspaper to their front doors on Sundays, or if he ran with a collection bag through the ranks. And finally, it also met the pastor with a vengeance, which could no one explain what got into him that he lost his temper so much. Rather than just poo over the others, he suddenly started, proclaimed the truth and nothing but the truth. This truth was so shocking and gruesome, that some mothers even hold closed the ears to their children.
I am a pederast. Yes, that's what I am. Each of my altar boys has given me a blowjob not only once or twice.
Many believed their ears not to be trusted. They blamed it on the cheap altar wine, the priest even drank outside of church. But to accuse himself of being a child molester, no normally man would do. And so wiped the initial shock a patch serenity and amusement. Although there are many already suspected for years, what the priest did to his protégés in the sacristy, nobody wanted to tell it out loud. Even now, as he scrawled it out loud, no one really wanted to hear it, and declared his failure with his drunkenness. The mood had not tarnished after all. Was it not been an open secret that they said nothing but better? And one highlight followed the next. No sooner were the ladies puked empty, they vomited green bile in between, has also been voted the best cake of the day. Although Justin might have recorded this as one more defeat, because he had not managed to get even one of the top three with his cake. He was more than satisfied with this extraordinary day, which now should again follow countless ordinary days. 10 days after, it was not uncommon for the pastor to break a real bread or a cake in pieces to give all of them a piece, when a funeral decency. This Wednesday's shocking high number of people were buried, who had died of an unexplained death. One person stuck a piece of cake in the throat, someone else probably had stuffed so much cake in him he simply blew his stomach, at least according to the report of the witnesses, which told nothing but the truth. A total of 7 coffins were laid out in front of the altar, and Justin thought about the fat bounty he would get from the visitors of this mess, when he took the cake in appearances, which the pastor was currently blessed and had been split in small pieces. Justin was scared. No matter what it may cost, he must prevent that. He got pushed some into his mouth. He picked up the basket and ran from row to row. Each person took a piece out of the basket. When Justin went back to the altar, he noted that 3 pieces lay in his basket. No matter what it may cost, he must prevent that. He was forced to receive the Eucharist. Shortly before the altar, he stumbled. The basket fell to the ground, and the pieces rolled still 10 feet away.
You stupid boy. Can't you be more careful where you step?
But that was nothing. Shortly thereafter, helter skelter broke out, and Justin had hardly witnessed something to compare with in his whole life before. Each abused or accused each other of such a terrible act of betrayal or a lie. And it seemed that suddenly somehow I would only be able to tell the truth, and that which had been building in recent years of lies, broke out of them.
You fucked my wife.
You steal the bills from the blame bag.
You're a stranger to me for years already.
You're a pig.
Justin, who had got up again, enjoyed the wild going on from a distance, as some began to beat even. And that on a day when they actually had to bring 7 bodies under the earth. At last the whole terrible truth came out of the closet that was happened in this strange city for years and far too often was swept under the carpet. Handcuffs clicked. Arrests and interrogations followed. And Justin left this place happy and fully satisfied, and not one of them entered it for any time or reason again. But before he wanted to devote himself to his usual hobbies, he still wanted to visit an extraordinary person he just was getting known better. Malice stood outside her house. Countless boxes and packed suitcases were ready for collection in her garden. Justin wondered.
My work in this city is done. I must move on now, where the winds take me.
Then probably the time has come to say goodbye. I assume that I will never see you again, said Justin, and embraced the old woman with both hands. Malice did not know at first what was happened. But then she stroked the boy's hair and said,
Herman has been done great magic to this city. What do you think, however, will probably happen when the magic on my cake begins to work?
Justin lifted his shoulders. What could a chocolate cake do so bad?
I do not want to be here any longer when his dark magic bewitches the whole city. Finally, I baked no ordinary chocolate cake, but a death by chocolate.